name is John Clark, and you just heard an unofficial national anthem of South Korea called Arirang. And actually, it's a countrywide, both North and South anthem song. And that's kind of the theme of today's lecture. It's the music of Lee Sung-yoon, and more specifically, his etude for solo flutes, not just single C flute, but the whole myriad of the auxiliary family. When I first encountered Lee Sung-yoon back in 95 as an undergraduate, I had no idea who this gentleman was. All I remember was looking at his music and panicking because it was just so complex. It was very complicated. And the demanding of the technical facility of the flutist is so high that it was actually a turnoff. But now that I'm a lot older, and I've lived a little bit more of life, and I've done a lot of research of Lee Sung-yoon, the etude has a very special place in my heart. So in order to understand Lee Sung-yoon's etude, I'd like to cite right now that when I was studying this piece, the idea of the elements came to my mind. And by elements, I mean, in Eastern philosophy, the elements revolve around five different elements: earth, water, wood, fire, and metal. And the metal is primarily gold. In the Western philosophy, we have only four: earth, wind, fire, and water. So that will set the precedence of the lecture, and I want to talk a little bit about Lee Sung-yoon and who he was, because that has such an impact of his work. Lee Sung-yoon was born in South Korea in the Sancheong Jeonsang South Province in 1917. His father was a poet and his mother was a farmer. He had an aptitude of music, however, which is very typically of Korean parents, they didn't foster the musical talent. But when he showed that he had an extreme interest and he was succeeding, his father relented and accepted that his son was going to take the path of a musician. In 1935, Lee Sung-yoon enrolled at the Osaka Conservatory in Japan, where he studied composition, theory, and cello. In 1955, he went back to Korea and received a Seoul City Cultural Award, which enabled him to study abroad, and more specifically, Western Europe, France, and Germany. In 1956, he enrolled at the famous Paris Conservatory. He studied composition with Tony Aubin and was a music theory pupil of Pierre Ravel, who happened to be a pupil of Durafley. After 1 year at the Paris Conservatory, Lee Sung-yoon proceeded to go to the West Berlin Hochschule in 1957. This is where I think his voice started to become molded to what you will hear in the etude. He was a composition student of Boris Blecher. He studied counterpoint and fugue with Reinhard Schwarz Schilling and 12-tone serialism with Josef Ruffer. 1958 was a very important year for Lee Sung-yoon because he went to the Darmstadt Music Festival. It's called the International Festival of Contemporary Music. And there, he met the likes of John Cage, Pierre Boulez, Igor Stravinsky, and Karlheinz Stockhausen. It was there he had the exposure of these avant-garde composers and their magnificent wild compositions that he became very interested more into the 12-tone system. And even his teacher, Ruffer, fostered Lee Sung-yoon's love for the 12-tone by saying, quote, "You are Asian. You have many great Oriental traditions. You should find your own voice from them." In 1970, Yoon eventually became a faculty member of the Hanover Musikhochschule in West Germany, teaching composition. And from 1972 to 1985, he held a full professorship at the Hochschule der Kunst in West Berlin. That's a little bit about Lee Sung-yoon's personal history. I'd like to talk a little bit about his political involvement. And this is the thing that just sparked such a huge interest and admiration for me. In my research, I came across a quote, and I have to do a little bit more research, but I like this quote, and I'm not sure if it's from Lee Sung-yoon himself, but it's so appropriate. The quote goes, "A politician cannot be a musician. However, a musician can be a politician." During Lee Sung-yoon's formative years, you have to remember that Korea was under Japanese occupation twice. Prior to that, it was in the later 19th century. And then also again, they came back when they defeated the Chinese. So when he was a student in Osaka, he was actually involved with some student underground activities. I guess you can equate it to the Black Panther movement here in the States. And he was captured by the Japanese police, and that was his first event of being tortured. And you also have to remember the Geneva Convention wasn't implemented then. So it was any man's game of how to punish someone. This, I believe, furthered his humanitarian efforts. I'm going to kind of fast forward to his more adult life, because Lee Sung-yoon did not believe in a divided Korea. He believed in a unified nation, both North and South, together as one. And so he and his wife actually visited North Korea, and it was in 1963 that sparked suspicion from the South Korean government. So again, at this time, the Japanese occupation has left, but it left some scarring in the mentality of the government. So anyone that had any involvement with anything communistic was an automatic red flag. So going to 1967, when he and his wife were in Berlin, they were kidnapped by the South Korean secret intelligence agency called the KCI. They were both tried for sedition and for being communist. And again, this goes back to the 1963 visit to North Korea. It was a threefold purpose. One was to visit a friend who actually wanted to live in Korea, but all he had South Korean citizenship. The second was that he and his wife wanted to know more about this newly formed communist government and the culture of North Korea, and also that there was some sort of memorial that they wanted to visit. And these are artists, so of course it makes a natural, you know, inclination to go visit something that's a little different from yours, because as a musician, I've always been taught that to expose yourself to other influences does enrich what you do. So going back to this abduction, this trial, they were both sentenced for life imprisonment. This caught the attention of many of the international avant-garde composers, musicians of high ranking. This goes back to when he was in 1958, when he went to the Darmstadt Festival. The men and the figures there all band together and had an international affidavit going around the world, which eventually landed in full support of the West German government as well to release Lee Sung-yoon. For the musicians out there, you'll recognize these names, and they're huge. The first one that came to mind was Igor Stravinsky. You also had the Karlheinz Stockhausen signature, Pierre Boulez, Heinz Holliger, and Herbert von Karajan. So the South Korean government, after seeing this, and there's a quote I'd like to read from the letter. "Mr. Yoon Lee-sung is a famous and great composer, not only in Europe, but also in the world. His goal is always to combine traditional Korean music with Western music. His musical works introduce Korean culture and art to the world. We would have known little about Korean culture. Nobody can nearly like him who introduced ideas of Korea throughout his music. The international world needs Mr. Lee Sung-yoon, who is an important composer, to combine Eastern and Western music. He is an ambassador of Korean music and culture." So the South Korean government released him, and he and his wife gained amnesty in 1970, and eventually they gained citizenship in Germany in 71. So being an Ausländer and then actually being revered in Germany and you're finally granted citizenship, for me that tells me that they had such an impact as people and as humanitarians and as artists. Some of his accolades actually include a performance of his opera Sinn Chong, which was performed at the opening ceremonies in the 72 Munich German Olympics. In 1985, he received an honorary doctorate from the University of Tübingen. In 1988, he received the Gold Cross for Distinguished Service of the German Order of Merit from West Germany. In 1992, he was awarded the Plakat Award from the Hamburg Academy. In 95, the Goethe Medal from Weimar and gained membership in the Hamburg and Berlin Academies of Arts. He also had, interestingly enough, close ties with the Berlin Philharmonic. They premiered his first and fifth symphonies celebrating their existence. So I believe it was their 100th and 150th celebration of, the Berlin Phil, and they asked this gentleman to write a symphony, and they premiered it. To be having the Berlin Philharmonic premiere work, that's a huge honor. In 1996, after his death, oh, he died in 1995, by the way. In 1996, the International Isangyun Society was formed in Berlin, and also there is an Isangyun International Music Festival in South Korea. So, what kind of stunned me when I was doing the research and reading more about this man's background is that there's not a lot of musicians or even composers that are aware of who Isangyun is. And even last year, when I was telling people that I was going to do the Isangyun Etude in for my lecture recital, I got a lot of blank stares. But the moment I started telling them about who Isangyun was and everything that he went through, and throughout all of this torture and hardship, he not once denounced his love for South Korea. So for me, it felt like a lesson in humanity. So now I'd like to talk a little bit about Isangyun's aesthetics. Well, as you heard in some of the quotes that I read about his ability to fuse the Western and Eastern compositional techniques, that's exactly what he did, which to me creates such a unique voice for Isangyun. He was able to weave intricate idioms of Korean folk music and Western music. And you'll also hear some of his influences of Taoism. There's a quote here I'd like to read. Quote, "I grew up under the influence of mysticism, of Taoism and Buddhism, and experienced that sense by reading books related to these philosophies. They had deep effect on my music. Over 70% of my works have been rooted in Taoism or Buddhism or based on the related legends. But these thematic backgrounds are not entirely necessary to understand my music." To give you a little idea, primarily what Taoism is, because I see that more in the Etude. Tao really means the way. It's a simplicity. It's an enlightenment. Man's relationship to nature. And it's also man's relationship to nature, to earth, to the universe. So it's an interesting hierarchy as you progress toward enlightenment. To further explain the differences between Western and Eastern music, Isangyun says, quote, "I do not write notes that suddenly appear or disappear. My notes always gain preparation, notes, and then settle down. As it repeats, musical vitality occurs." So this is where the Taoist element comes into play. Another quote, "While in European music, the concept of form plays a decisive part and notes become significant only when a whole group of them are related horizontally as melody or vertically as harmony. The thousand-year-old tradition of Eastern Asiatic music places the single note, the constructive element, in the foreground. In European music, only a series of notes comes to life, so that the individual tones can be relatively abstract, but with us, the single tone is alive in its own right. Our notes can be compared to brush strokes as opposed to pencil lines. So, having the Korean background and the experience of Korean music, and also the influence of the Chinese and the Japanese Asiatic influences, and having the experience of studying at the Hochschule in Germany and the Paris Conservatory, this man really knows what he's talking about. He's pretty much what we would say legit. So for the next portion, I'm going to proceed with explanation of the etude, the natural element influences. But before I do that, I'd like to acknowledge the fact that this approach is my own interpretive analysis. I have done a lot of research primarily through other people's dissertation writings. And so their dissertations were basically on the theory itself. But like I said, when I was going through this, and a good friend of mine even suggested this, he said, you know, this kind of sounds like the five elements in Asian philosophy. So the more I played, the more I looked, the more I studied, it was overwhelmingly true. So this is a five movement work. The first movement is what I believe is the water movement. The second movement is molten metal. The third movement is fire. The fourth movement is wind. And the fifth movement is earth. So if you take a look at the first page on the handout, you'll notice that there are two charts. The first is the aesthetics, and the bottom part is what I labeled the relationships. So one of the relationships I found, the first movement is water in liquid form, and the liquid form, the state of matter, is what connects that to the molten metal. The molten metal can only be in that state of matter when there's intense heat applied to it. So the heat is related to the fire movement, because without heat, you actually have nothing to spark something off. Fire is fed through the gases and oxygen in the air. So therefore, the fire and the wind movement are related by the component of air. All four of these elements in combination create the earth. You have the erosive and weathering qualities of wind and water. Fire can also provide life, but it can also scar. And then you have the wind. It just made sense. So, a side note, like I said, Lee Sung-yoon loved the culture and the history of Korea. One of the oldest art forms is called pansori. And I kept this in mind when I was practicing, studying. And pansori basically is a very old entertainment but storytelling technique which is passed down verbally. It incorporates a singer who stands in front of the stage, and then to the side you have a percussionist who clicks, bangs, and reiterates whatever the singer is saying to emphasize the storytelling. And the pansori singer is not just a singer. The pansori singer has to be able to emulate various sounds you will find in nature, such as a waterfall, a bird, a wind. So that was one of my biggest challenges when I was preparing this piece. And you will also notice that I have a variety of instruments up here. I have the bass flute, I have the alto flute, I have the piccolo, and I have the concert C flute. And I will explain more of the importance of these different instruments as I go along through the different movements. Another aspect of the Tao is the balance of opposites. If you look at the Korean flag, you'll notice a circle, and in the middle, you'll see a very curved dividing line that represents the yin and the yang, the male, the female, night, light, cold, hot. And in order for you to live in a peaceful way, you have to have that balance. And so this piece, out of many pieces I played, is so uniquely different because you have the bass flute low, you have the tempo high, and you have everything in between. So there's that balance, the Taoist balance. So the next thing is, I'd like to go quickly through the compositional aesthetics. In the top of the chart, you'll notice that to the left, I typed up the Western influences, and then to the right, I wrote the Yun aesthetics. The Yun aesthetic is a little bit of a misnomer, but just to also clarify, the Yun aesthetics includes what we would call the contemporary extended technique. So the Western influences, one of the interesting things is in this piece, he has temple markings, which kind of goes against the Pansori tradition. If something's verbal, you really don't have a tempo marking given. You just kind of sing along and you just understood that, oh, this song is fast, or this song is slow. Some of the other influences that you will hear as well, I wrote down embellishments of notes within melismatic passages, trills, grace notes. And I'm not gonna go ahead and read all the way down because I'm gonna explain the usage in the etude. But what's interesting, if you go to the right, the aesthetics of Yun, he uses what's called the main tone technique, and that's his version of the 12-tone technique. And you'll also see in the handouts at the top of all the movements, I wrote out the tones that he uses primarily in each of the movements here. He does extreme dynamic contrasts. He writes a ridiculous quadruple piano to a ridiculously loud quadruple forte. So you can translate that as pianississimo and the fortississimo, which just means very, very soft and uncontrollably very, very loud. He uses tuplets quite often here, and tuplets are the groupings of the notes, and so more specifically, he uses a lot of quintuplets and septuplets and non-tuplets. And here, the vibrato, it's shared in both the Western and Yun's aesthetic, but in a Western usage, vibrato is a little bit more calculated. So if I were to draw a wavelength of a vibrato, it's a very smooth, undulating waveform. In the Pansori or the Korean or Isong Yun's aesthetic, it's very intense, it loosens up, it gets in the middle, it intensifies, so there's a huge variety of vibrato there. And also I believe that he uses the influence of the daedrum, which is the Korean flute. And so I'm not gonna go ahead and read further down. Again, I'm going to point those out in each of these etudes. So, if you turn to movement number one, the moderato, we have the water movement. And so, I'm sure it's safe to say that we've all had the experience of going to the beach. We've all had the experience of feeling the undertow, undercurrent, hopefully no riptide, but also having the experience of being washed, wiped out. So you know the strength of the beach, the water in itself. So the characters of water would be this undulating, uneven pattern of the ebb and flow of the oceanic water. And you can feel the different contrasting and conflicting currents underneath your feet. So this is basically about a wave beginning with two grace notes, cresting, forming again, and cresting. And eventually it reaches the shore. So if you look at figure one, you'll notice that I did a lot of the scribble up there, but I also labeled some of the Western influences up there. This is such an important introduction to the whole piece because it sets the precedence of his fusion of Western and Eastern influences in compositional technique. The very two small notes at the very beginning, labeled grace notes, set up the B flat, with the B flat you use an intense vibrato, and then it crashes with a set of four grace notes, and there you also have the aspect of melisma followed by a rest. Now that rest is called ma. Ma is a Japanese term for a negative space. Not a void, but a negative space. When you think of void, you think there's no activity going on whatsoever, so it's empty. It's an empty space. There's an emptiness to it. Not with ma. Ma, it may appear empty, but within that stillness, there's still an intense activity going on. It's a bit of an abstract concept, but when I play through this, you'll feel a lot of ma, and then you have to feel it to experience it. And then you have the cresting of the wave again. You have the grace note, melismatic grace notes, and then you have another larger ma. And then again, you have the grace note setting up another wave, and it crashes. An intervallic relationship. So if you have a spacing of a seventh, each progressive note going toward the center note will get smaller. Seventh or a fifth or a fourth or a third. So this is again another unique aspect. He was able to combine the Korean aesthetic with the westernized technique. I circled the very beginning with the G sharp and the A. And then there's another grouping, C sharp, E, F. And then moving ahead, you have a D sharp, E, G. So the measure starting with 31, the tonal center is E, natural. Following that in measure 46, you have the C sharp. Now if you notice, they're in different sizes. So that also represents the different strengths and sizes of each little wave. So you have the G sharp, A, C sharp, and it's all leading up to the high E. Piano. You'll see in his music, he has a lot of that to distinguish between, again, the dao element of high and low. High, forte, low, piano. He incorporates the non-tuplets here. They are in a melismatic character. And you notice at the tail end, you see those funny looking signs right there, and that indicates that the flutist keeps playing those exact same notes, but without sound. But you have to make sure you slap the keys loud enough to represent those notes coming out. And to me, that's the approach of the wave at the shore, and as it starts to dissipate, that's where you have the clicking of the keys. I'm going to start a little bit before that, so that way you can actually feel the setup of the dissipation. Movement two is the molten metal movement. I think the choice of the alto flute is very clever here because the alto flute is voiced lower than the regular flute that you just heard. It has a larger bore, and the sonority is something what I would consider a little unearthly. And so knowing that, I envisioned that this molten river of metal is beneath the surface. And when you think of hot, molten metal, you have gas escaping. It's going to swallow things in its way. It's going to bubble. It's going to fizz. And it's also going to cool down. And so, again, this is just a genius of Lee Sung-yoon incorporating Western technique with Korean storytelling. He does set this as an adagio tempo, which is very slow. The alto flute is starting at a very low register note. And then there, as I play some of these, you'll also hear it go a little higher as well. So if you start at figure five, the opening is at a very, very slow tempo and a low tempo and low notes. And then above it, I labeled breathy tone. And that's a technique to create an unfocused sound, and this is where I think that you have the gases bubbling up and evaporating into the air. And the flutter tonguing for me represents the portions of this river cooling off. Figure six, he incorporates pitch bends. So it's basically what it implies. You play one note and you're going to bend it either up or down. And that, for me, represents the changing of the molten river. You have this technique called diminution. So you have a note value, and as it gets smaller, the note transition gets faster and faster. It becomes diminutive, but not diminutive in the amount of notes. It's just the diminutive in the spacing of the notes. So that, to me, is parts of the river quickly passing the cooler parts. You have, again, ma. This time, unlike his other previous ma's, he actually writes a fermata above this ma. So I interpret that as however long I'd like for it to be. Because soon after that, you're going to hear pizzicato, again, a Western technique. Flutter tonguing, that's in a melismatic passage, and again, it's going to end with the flutter tonguing. So story for me is the pizzicato, the river bumps into an object, it gets swallowed up. The melisma is the changing of direction of the river, and the flutter again is the cooling off of the molten metal. Seven, you'll notice that there's a huge line here I labeled the oblique motion. Out of all the movements, this is the longest one here. And for that, I feel that it is a building of a molten wave of metal. Because as it progresses, you'll also notice in figure 7.5, it's not part of the attached staple, you'll notice that there's a lot of pizzicato and short productions of notes up and down. So it's leading, it keeps leading to something. And for me, in figure 8, it leads to the extended technique of multiphonics, and the multiphonics represent the cooling, actually cooling of the river. And again, with the oblique motion, you have the D, B flat, F, E, and those are the circled notes, and they're always leading up to the main note of the E flat. And then you'll also notice four other sets of couplets here that lead up to the E flat. And it's also concluded with a flutter, which is the melismatic passage. To movement 3. This is the fire movement. Out of all the movements, this was the easiest one for me to parse because some of the Western techniques are more obvious here. You have the use of trills and tremolos. He has a very explicit use of sequences. He uses oblique motion. In the midst of that, he mixes in note bends. He has ma, he has tuplets. The elements of Tao are evident with the high and low, loud and soft dynamics. If you look at figure 9, starting at measure 8, you see a group of four quintuplets. Those quintuplets to me represent the ever-changing irregular shaping of a flame. A flame isn't ever, it's never stagnant, it's always static, it's moving. The trills represent flames growing, the rising temperatures, the different sequences here, as you'll notice here, after the quintuplets, it's a fire that's starting to just gradually get smaller, but it will eventually grow into a huge inferno. Because towards the end, you'll hear it growing and growing. I have also, if we look down in figure 10, I have a sequence of rising tremolos here. And what I'll do, I'll play all of these examples after I explain this. You have oblique motion again in figure 11, and then pitch bends in figure 12. Which represents the fire nato, which is a tower of fire. Pitch bends here are very interesting because he only has three, that are just quarter tone pitch bends. The other ones have to be more or less whole tone or half a full half tone pitch bend, which is a little difficult for piccolo because the embouchure hole is so small. So, admittedly, I cheat just a little bit so that way you'll hear more of the difference. For example, in the C sharp, the A. And then you have the quarter. C, F, so I would say that out of all the other movements, this is the most intense for me because it is just so active. I think you'll agree with me after you hear this movement played in its entirety, you'll also feel that the inferno building very, very quickly. Going to movement number 4, it is played on the bass flute. As you can see, the bass flute is very, very long, and the head joint has to be curved for me to accommodate to play the keys. Otherwise, I would feel like a little kid trying to play an adult flute. It just wouldn't work. It is unique because of the bigger bore, it has a very low voicing. The large size contributes to the lower dark timbral colors. It does take a little bit more physical strength to play this instrument. It's at a slow tempo, which represents for me a very slow and heavy, dense air, almost visible. It's also very characteristic of old Korean superstitions. Koreans are very superstitious people. Old Koreans are. My mother is a perfect example. She is very spooked out when certain changes in the weather actually happen. And she's very cautious about things that she will do. She won't clean the house if she knows she's traveling long distances that day for some reason. She doesn't tell me why, but I guess that's a little bit of a superstition that I'm just gonna respect and not question. But there's something very underlying about this movement as well. And I'll get to that in figure 14. So figure 13, Lee Sung-yoon just mushes and just fills the opening with a lot of the Western and Korean aesthetics again. You have the fluttering and fluttering again, followed by ma. And on the second line, you'll notice I wrote flutter with breathy tone. This is the first time something like this has occurred. So it creates a very interesting timbre color change in the flute. And then you also have the pitch bends. Figure 14, you have the multiphonics again. And then here, following that, you have what's called Stimme, which is singing. So I will be singing into the flute. I'll start on a trill, I will sing that same note, then I will trill a little higher and I will sing a little lower, and that creates contrapuntal motion right there. And it also creates a nice dissonance when I'm singing the same note. I go up to a half step, minor third, and back down and have a dissonance of a minor third, or minor second, excuse me. Now, when I said this has an underlying meaning, I believe that this is Yun remembering how he was tortured by his own countrymen and by the Japanese. There's a Korean word or Korean phrase called kasam apo, which means my chest, my heart hurts. So playing the Stimme and the multiphonics and all these low extended techniques, I can't help but think about this is probably what he was going through while he was waiting his fate in prison. So I'm just going to go ahead and begin. Many of these techniques are, again, self-explanatory because I explained them a little bit in the previous movements. So as you heard, it's a very colorful instrument. And I think Isam Yun really wanted to capture the flexibility of this instrument with this movement. So for the finale, movement 5. As I said earlier in the lecture, the previous 4 movements represent the 4 elements combined. It fuses together. What's interesting, again, in Taoism, there's another thought process is that you begin in one spot and you return to that original spot again. It's a cycle of life. I began on C flute, I'm ending on C flute. detail with the two figures here, because again, a lot of it is already explained from the other movements. What's interesting is that all 12 tones are utilized in this movement. There's an obvious Western rondo form here. You have section A, section B, section A, and it's concluded with a very small coda at the end. Section A is activity, section B, stillness. Section A, activity, the coda, stillness. So again, there's that Taoist element of contrasting balances. I've listed here, he uses the technique of the vibrato, the melisma, and over here, another Taoist element that I found was the contrasting of the F sharp. The F sharp is very small at the very beginning of measure 13. And then above that, you'll notice high F naturals. And eventually, at the very end, right where I wrote the word, the initial P-I-Z-Z, pizzicato, is an F sharp. Again, another Taoist element of contrasts. F sharp fighting F natural. F sharp and F natural. He uses, in figure 16, at the very bottom, double octaves. Double octaves are a Western technique you'll find in string. You'll find that in Kreutzer exercises, you'll find it in the Paganini, where the string player has to work, do double octaves or two of the same notes. I'm doing something a little different than what's suggested in this edition. There are trick fingerings here, but I was playing around with that, and I don't think it's appropriate, because if this is a Korean influenced piece, and if this is about pansori, this is about storytelling, I want to stay true to that and pretend I'm a Korean flutist here and use my embouchure and jaw to oscillate from the low and high, and you'll hear that. And also he combines that with pitch bend, so he's going all out with this particular movement. Figure 17, there are double octaves again, and this time he mixes it in with a singing underneath. This is particularly challenging for the performer, especially for me, because my hearing skills go a little bit crazy when I'm doing all these double octaves, so don't hold it against me if I can't quite hit an E-flat and a D. And then here are the sequences of the heavens. So in figure 18, you'll notice that you have a set of tremolos rising up to a high G. The second set, tremolo rising up to a high F natural, so on and so forth. So this is from section B of this music. Now, in Tao, it's not only the relationship of nature and man and earth, but I think this is where the pansori singer is sitting on the mountainside, and he finally rises up to the heavens, because that's represented with the notes going all the way up to the higher octave, and there's a decrescendo. So that is, performance-wise, quite challenging. And then it ends here on one of the highest notes for the standard flute range. And this particular movement, again, the opposition of high-low, it incorporates the lowest note on a standard flute, low C, and it goes up to a fourth octave C sharp, and it eventually ends on a fourth octave F, fourth octave C natural. So I'm going to play the sequence of the heavens.
Thank you.
multitude. So my closing argument is that by using each of the different members of the flute family here as a vehicle for the different timbral and technical demands of Lee Sung-yoon's compositional aesthetics, I believe I have proven that the elements of nature are present in this work of Etude. This was a very hard journey, mentally, physically, and emotionally, because when I was reading a lot of what Lee Sung-yoon had to go through, I couldn't help but think about that when I was practicing this piece. And I don't like to just call it a piece of work or a composition. It's more than that to me. It's truly a piece of art. So I will perform the whole etude from beginning to end. Before I do that, I would like to make a couple public acknowledgments. First, I would like to thank my marvelous flute instructor, the consummate artist Aaron Goldman. His artistic input and support truly has helped me to elevate my appreciation of the music of Lee Sung-yoon, as well as the art form of music itself. I would like to extend my gratitude to the encyclopedic Dr. William Montgomery for his words and worlds of experience. Also, although my friend isn't here right now, my dongsang Alyssa Oh, she was the one who helped me write the Korean letterings. I have no idea what I was writing, and she just did it, and then I copied exactly. I mean, I literally put the piece of paper and just copied it like that. And last but not least, my dear friend Brian Swan. He had to hear me play this for the past 2 months over and over again. And so I'd like to extend a great thank you for that. I mean, he had to endure a lot of relentless noise making in our home. So I hope you enjoyed my lecture on the Lee Sung-yoon Etude, and now I'm going to perform it for you.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.